Glad to have you to join in with us one more Sunday morning here at St. Philip Monumental African Methodist Episcopal Church in the beautiful city of Savannah, Georgia. We certainly thank and praise God for each and every one of you that join in with us Sunday after Sunday. We hope and pray that since we have assembled the last time, that you have witnessed the joy of Jesus. We are now in, of course, the season of Advent. We are certainly looking forward to the coming of Christ, of course, as the Bible lets us know. And we certainly thank and praise God for you. We ought to just thank God for us being here this close to another Christmas day, another Christmas celebration. And so as we continue on, I want to encourage each and every one of you to please go out and vote. If you have not voted, please go out and vote. Also, want to encourage each and every one of you that are celebrating birthdays this week to have a happy birthday. You're celebrating an anniversary. We pray that you will have a happy anniversary also. We certainly thank and praise God again for each and every one of you. So glad to have with us this morning Reverend Timothy Curry, wonderful young man of God. He's going to come and he's going to bless us with our invocation. After he has blessed us with our invocation, we will hear from none other than Sister Tricia Gaines. She is our Christian Education Director here at St. Philip Monumental, and she is celebrating her birthday on today. So we certainly thank and praise God for her celebrating her birthday on today. They will come now in that order.
Good morning, church family. Let us bow and pray. Most everlasting, eternal God, we come before you with humbleness in our heart. We thank you for this season, God, for this season of caring and giving and sharing. We thank you for the Jesus, the baby, the Christ, coming to earth to celebrate for mankind everywhere. We ask God, you continue to touch every home, every member, every listener, every viewer, God, and to their own little place, God, would you meet them there and remind them of the reason for this season. We thank you, God, for all the blessings that flow from heaven, some that we're worthy of and some that not even so worthy of, but your job is always blessing us. We thank you for this. And these and all things we ask now in Jesus' name as we celebrate this season. Amen and amen.
Good morning. What a joy it is to be before you today to share some words from my Lord and Jesus Savior. Our scripture this morning comes from Luke, the second chapter. I'll be reading the first through the seventh verses. The birth of Jesus. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. The word of God for the people of God.
Hark, the herald angels.
Again, to each and every one of you joining in with us on today, we certainly hope and pray that you're having a wonderful day, and you will have a wonderful day on today. To Reverend Timothy Curry and to Sister Patricia Gaines, we certainly thank and praise God for them. Want to continue to wish her a happy birthday, Sister Gaines, on today, and to countless others of you that are celebrating your birthdays, not only today, but this week. May God bless you to have many, many more. From the passage of scripture that Sister Gaines read for us, I would like to focus just for a few moments on this seventh verse. The seventh verse says, "And she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloth and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them." I would like to leave the subject with you on today. The subject simply says, the greatest gift ever. The greatest gift ever. We are now, many of us are contemplating and looking forward to getting gifts and giving gifts on this week and giving individuals gifts or family gifts and making sure that we have done the right thing. So many times, I believe that there are those who may be disappointed in some of the gifts that you may get. However, I want you to know that it is important that we understand what a gift really is. So many times as we continue on and we travel and we talk and converse with individuals, sometimes we find that we don't understand the meaning or even the logic behind giving a gift. For just a few moments, I would like to just focus on doing such. When we look at us, you and I, giving gifts, many times we love to see the receiver. We love to see him or her. We love to see them smiling, and we love to see them laughing and really appreciating the gift. Every now and then, we've all, those of us who are of age, we've all given someone a gift, only to see that they seem to be as if they were disappointed in the gift that we gave them. When they seem to be disappointed in the gift that we give them, sometimes we tend to be even more disappointed, and every now and then we'll even get into our own little zone and declare to ourselves that you ought to be happy about the gift because I really didn't even have to give it to you. However, sometimes that doesn't help things. It just tends to harm them even more. And so I've come to tell you today that so many of you will be receiving gifts this week. You ought to get it right in your heart and your being right now that no matter what someone gives to you, that you're going to be happy to receive that gift. That no matter how minuscule or how large the gift is, that you're just happy. Why? Because no one had to give you anything. And so it is that when we get a gift is just that, something that someone gave to us. A gift, if you will, and be honest with yourself, is something that many times we don't even deserve. We didn't do anything to deserve it. We didn't say anything to deserve it. So many times we find ourselves receiving gifts because of the gift giver. When we look at individuals, there are people who just love to give gifts. And there are some who don't care how you look when they give you the gift. They're going to give it to you. We all have those in our family. Doesn't care what you say. Sometimes they'll even pick some of the gifts that they think. Sometimes you may not even like. They're not really concerned about that. But when we understand what a gift really is, we can truthfully say that we thank God for everything that someone gives us. If someone should give you a set of shoestrings this year instead of a pair of shoes, why don't you tell God thank you and tell them thank you, no matter what the gift is. We have to be in a spirit, if you will, of receiving gifts. We have to be in a spirit of receiving gifts. And gifts, amen, come, of course, from God. When someone give you something, they didn't just give it to you because that's just the thing to do. So many times, they heard from God to tell them to give you this or that or the other. Sometimes a gift that you may receive, maybe one that you may not need right now. We all have gotten gifts that wonder why they gave me this gift. I don't need anything like this now. But as you live on, you find yourself coming to a time or a point where you do need that particular gift. Sometimes God allows gift givers to have some foresight and to give you something that you may not need right now, but to give you something that you're going to need somewhere in the future. And you ought to still say, thank God, no matter what it is, and no matter if you can't connect the dots with needing it right now, if you can't connect the dots with why did they give me this, still hold on, because sometime you're going to still need it. Other gifts are given to us, and we can re-gift. We can give them to someone else. And you shouldn't be telling people when you're re-gifting, and certainly don't tell the giver, and don't tell the receiver either. But some gifts are just that good, that we've gotten them and we realize that we have two or more of the same gifts, and it's not for us to harbor them. Sometimes we can give them to someone else. Sometimes the gift really did not mean that much to you, but you did say thank you, and you thank God for it. But you find somewhere along the line, someone in your family, some of your friends, someone who could probably appreciate that gift even more than you. So gifts come in an array of forms. Gifts come, amen, in an array of times, and they come from an array of people. And so we should all be thankful for the gift. And why do I say all of this? I say all of that to encourage each and every one of us to understand one of the greatest gifts that we've ever gotten. Someone is concerned right now. You're thinking about the fact that you need some things come Christmas morning. And you're hoping and praying that the gifts that you will get will satisfy those needs. But I come to tell you that one of the greatest gifts that could ever happen to you and happen for me, we've already been given that gift, and we ought to just praise God for it. When we look here in the gospel as recorded by Luke, we find the story of Jesus being born in a manger. And many of us are familiar with this story from Sunday school. We're familiar with this story from Bible study. We're familiar with this story from church services. And so it is that we find Jesus and Mary, of course, and Joseph, and they're coming, and some are still arguing or debating this, but here they are in Bethlehem, find themselves that it is time for Mary to give birth to a son that will be named Jesus. And I come to tell you today that when we look at the birth of Jesus, we've been debating, and we've been, many of us as preachers and teachers and of the gospel, many times we have said and debated, you know, why would he be born in a manger, and which in essence was a trough in a stable, if you will. But we find that he could have been born anywhere. He's the Son of God. He could have been born anywhere. But look at his humble beginnings. Look where he started from. And so it is that you and I ought to look where we started from. The Bible lets us know that the reason that he was born, amen, in a manger was because there was no room available for him at the inn. There was no room available for him even at the Holiday Inn, if you will, or the hotel, as many of us would know today, or the motel. But when we see God working, God works in mysterious ways. And I've learned that when God has to get his point across, or when God wants to do something, there is nothing and nobody that can stand in the way of what God would do. And somebody ought to just rejoice with that today, because you're trying to get some things done in your life. And everywhere you turn, you look around and you see someone standing in the way. But I come to tell you today that you ought not lose much sleep over that, because the God I serve and the God that you serve, that he's able, amen, to move those obstacles out of your way. I love the Lord. Why? Because he has a way of satisfying those of us who will trust in him, satisfying those of us who believe in him. Someone is saying, what am I talking about? I'm coming back to the scripture, but for your sake today, that when we do want something to be done in a particular way, when we do want something to be done at a particular time, sometimes God just don't do it. What am I talking to you? What am I saying to you? I'm saying that if you want a Cadillac, for God to bless you with a Cadillac, there are two ways that that can be done. God can bless you with the Cadillac, or he can remove the desire. So praise God, from whom all blessing flows. Those of us who are of age, we have lived long enough to know that every now and then God didn't give us what we wanted to have, but his will was still done. He made a way for us. He took us away from wanting that thing that he did not want us to have, and he gave us what he wanted us to have. And we ought to praise God for that. When we look at what was going on here in the scripture, we find that I'm sure that Mary and Joseph could have had questions as to why was there not any room in the inn. But at the end of the day, God still made a way for them. Still made a way for baby Jesus to be born. Born in a manger, again, a trough. Born in a stable. What is a stable? Animals were in the stable. But praise God, from whom all blessings flow. I'm just talking to you today. Perhaps there was never another baby that was born in a manger or a trough and in a stable prior to baby Jesus. Perhaps there may have not have been one that was born since, but that's all right with me. Because when we see Jesus coming, he's a trailblazer from the beginning. Look at what God allowed to happen to him. So he was born from humble beginnings. And we ought to thank God, because you come from humble beginnings too. Be honest with yourself. You did not have everything that you have now. You didn't have that all the time. But thank God he blessed you to be able to come from wherever you came from, to get to wherever you are today. But in the midst of God blessing us, he blessed us with the greatest gift of all. And that greatest gift of all is Jesus Christ. You ought to thank God for blessing you with a gift on today. God has already given you. I don't care if you don't get nothing for Christmas, if you don't get nothing for your birthday, you've already got the greatest gift that you can have. The greatest gift of all is Jesus Christ. How do I know that the greatest gift is Jesus Christ? Because he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me that I am his own. He lets me know that if I never get everything that I want, I got everything I need, and that is in Jesus Christ. If I never get everything I want, I got everything I need. I have a Savior who loves me. I have a Savior who wakes me up in the morning time. I have a Savior who sometimes even wakes me up in the middle of the night and calls me to call on His name. I have a Savior who looks out for me. He looks out for my children. He looks out for all those around me. I have a Savior that looks out for the church. He looks out for me on the job. He looks out for me everywhere I go. Every now and then, I seem that I can't see Him. Every now and then, I feel as if He's nowhere around me, but I've lived long enough to know that He has never left me, and He has never forsaken me, that even when I can't see Him, that's the time that He's working on my behalf. Especially when I can't feel Him, that's the time that He's working on my behalf. So I thank God for the gift. Why do I thank God for the gift of Jesus Christ? Because He came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. Not only did He do that, He died so that we could have everlasting life. What a mighty God we serve. The greatest gift of all is the one that will allow you to take your next breath. The greatest gift of all is the one that will allow you on the cloudiest day to still see the sun shining. The greatest gift of all is the one that will allow you when you're on your sick bed to still be able to call on His holy and His righteous name. The greatest gift of all is Jesus Christ. And may you celebrate Him. May you continue to look to Him. Don't get angry at the gift that you may not get or the gift that you may get that you don't like. Because actually, we come to celebrate Jesus' birthday, not ours in essence. But the fact of the matter is that you and I already have the greatest gift of all. And to you, that individual that may have not already received Him into your life, what a wonderful Sunday. What a wonderful time for you to receive the greatest gift of all. Jesus Christ. Invite Him into your life. Invite Him into your heart. He will come in, and He'll come in and see about you. The greatest gift of all. Thank God for you, and especially you. Thank you for your support of this ministry and other ministries. We thank you for everything that you've given. So many of you have done so much sacrificing since last Christmas or this year, and you've done it even in the midst of a pandemic, and we thank you. Perhaps you will continue, please, to support this ministry. There are those who still drop theirs by us, those who put it in the mail. 1112 Jefferson Street, Savannah, Georgia. There are others who go to GiveLify and give that way. By whatever means you give, we certainly thank you because you don't have to do it, but thank you for doing it. May God bless and keep you is my prayer. God bless you.
He is Christ the Lord. Come on.
Oh, come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come, ye are coming to Bethlehem.
I want to be a come.
So come and Let's bring it out.
Christ the Lord.
We call you King.
Christ the Lord.